Good afternoon and welcome to Pantry's overview of the Paycheck Protection Flexibility Act of 2020. Some important changes to the original rules of the Paycheck Protection Act. I'm Kathy Graham. I'm head of the HR services area at Pantry. I want to welcome you to this session this afternoon. I will be sending everyone that's in attendance a copy of the slide presentation after the webinar is over. And if you, during the webinar, you have any questions, please type them into the chat area on your screen and I will answer them at the end of this session. Okay. The Paycheck Protection Flexibility Act of 2020. We're going to talk today about several things. We're going to talk about the different changes. The first is the length of the spending timeframe has been extended. The amount that you're required to spend on payroll has been lowered. The deadline for restoration of your workforce and wages has been extended. There are also two new alternatives to restore your reduction in forgiveness. Exciting news, the loan term has been extended and your eligibility to defer payroll taxes has been modified. And then we're going to go into clarifications on some each of those. But first of all, let's talk about the act itself. It was signed into law, signed into law on June the 5th, 2020, and it does modify some of the terms that are related to the Paycheck Protection Program Loan Forgiveness, which is a big deal for a lot of business owners right now. So current PPP borrowers can choose a 24-week period for use of the funds when the previous limit was 8 weeks. Even if you elected the 8 weeks originally, you can change to the 24-week period. However, that period cannot extend past December the 31st of this year. The required payroll expenditure is now 60% of the borrowed amount instead of 75%, which was the original amount. If the 60% level is not met, right now the law says that there is no forgiveness available. That will be changing, I'm sure, because Congress has been discussing it already, looking at a sliding scale for how much is spent. The deadline for restoration of your workforce levels has been extended to December the 31st of this year, knowing that the original deadline was June the 30th. So that's good news for a lot of individuals who are just now getting their businesses back up and running. The two new alternatives that have been offered to restore potential reduction in forgiveness for your workforce replacement is that, first of all, if you are unable to find a qualified replacement for certain employees, that is okay. You'll still be working on that after the PPP period is over. And they do recognize that if you are missing a key person, it may be difficult to hire them. They also an inability to restore your business operations to the February 15th of 2020 due to operating restrictions. Every state has different rules about when certain businesses can open and what level they can open. Restaurants in our area can have a 50% capacity. I know that some in the past in other states have had a 25% capacity, for example, for restaurants. So that's an important restriction when you are trying to satisfy the forgiveness rules. They also changed the way that you calculate your full-time equivalents. The full-time or FTE, which stands for full-time equivalent calculation, now uses a 40-hour work week, and you can elect to count all your part-time employees as half-time instead of actually determining what percentage of an employee they are. The prior calculation did use the Affordable Care Act rule of 30 hours. That is gone. You can use 40 hours, and every part-timer you have counts as a 0.5. Another change here is that the full-time equivalent headcount not reduced for an employee who receives an offer of employment from you that's rejected. And I've talked to a number of employers that can't get their employees to come back to work because they're making more than they were making at work by claiming unemployment. If they were terminated for cause, if someone voluntarily resigned or asked for a reduction in hours, or if you're unable to rehire an employee or find a qualified replacement, all of those are reasons for not rehiring an individual. Those would be included as reasons for not rehiring under the forgiveness requirements. Also, you're unable to restore your business operations to February the 15th of 2020 levels due to COVID-19 operating restrictions. The old rules, remember the old rules for the 8-week plan still exist as they were, but this is just in addition to. So it's giving you more flexibility. You can still use the period of time in 2019 that you used to determine whether or not or what your headcount was, and you can use the new rules. So you're not restricted to these new rules. You can still use the old if you'd like. And the loan term now has been extended from 2 years to 5 years, which means you have 5 years to pay back anything that is not forgiven. The interest rate is still 1%, and your lending institution may require that you complete a new loan agreement. So if you are going to require or request a change like that, go back to your lending institution and talk with them. Companies that have PPP loans can defer the company portion of payroll taxes, which is your FICA tax, through 2020, so through the end of this year. The prior rule allowed the deferral only through the date that the company received loan forgiveness. Now it is through the remainder of the year. So those of you who thought you'd have to stop the deferral after your loan forgiveness, you are in luck. You can still defer that, although they will still have to be paid back half by the end of 2021, and half by the end of 2022, just as the original rules stated. So look at some clarification on wages. There have been a lot of questions about payroll dates and payroll costs. Eligible payroll costs include those that are paid and incurred during the covered period. That covered period begins on the date funds are received. And payroll costs are deemed incurred on the day that an employee earns their pay, not the date that they get paid. Payroll costs incurred during a 24-week period and paid on or before the next payroll date are eligible for forgiveness. So this includes the first regular payroll following the 24-week period. This definition of wages would also apply to the 8-week period. And borrowers who pay employees biweekly or more frequently, like weekly, have an option to elect an alternate covered period. That period would start with the first day of the employee's pay period following the date of receipt of the loan proceeds. For example, if a company received their funds on April the 20th and the first day of the next payroll period begins on April the 26th, calculation of eligible wages can begin on April the 26th. The 24-week period would begin on that date for wage purposes. Health insurance eligible costs would include those costs paid or incurred during that 24-week period. This includes, as before, self-insured programs, and it is reduced by any employee contributions for health insurance. Retirement plans, we still have a lot of questions lingering on this, but eligible costs would be those paid or incurred during the 24-week period, just as the 8-week period outlined. There is additional guidance pending on safe harbor plans. Right now, it looks as though if you can convince the lender that you are not able to financially make those payments, or I'm sorry, not the lender, but your third party administrator, you need to talk to them because they would be the ones that would give you advice on whether or not you could suspend your contributions and make it up at year end. But talk to your third party administrator for your retirement plan on that. Employer state taxes. This includes the amounts that are assessed on employee compensation paid by the borrower. It appears to include state employer taxes paid through a payroll company rather than only those paid directly to the state agency. There was some confusion about that before, but if a company is paying the taxes for you, instead of you paying them directly to the state agency, that is included. And state withholding taxes are not included for the employee. Non-payroll costs, there were some clarifications, rent, mortgage, interest, and utilities. Non-payroll costs must be paid and incurred or incurred during that 24-week period, just as in the 8-week period, and paid on or before the next billing date, even if that date falls outside the 24-week period. And we are assuming that this would also apply to the 8-week period. You may not prepay any of these costs. And in these clarification, they did determine that vehicles and equipment count as non-payroll costs under rent. Utilities include your electricity, gas, water, telephone, internet, and transportation costs. Transportation costs needs more clarification. Right now, we do know that it includes gasoline or fuel. So in conclusion, the PPP loan forgiveness application provides the borrower with planning and compliance tools when using the fund. And each company is going to have specific situations that has to be addressed with their lender. We know that there will be additional clarification and information on this new law, and we will keep you up to speed on this as those changes happen. And if you do have any questions, please type them in the chat, or you can type them, you could send me an email after this is over, and I will do the research for you. But it looks like we have a question here. Can the PPP forgiveness report be adjusted to translate salaried employees to be reflected with the number of full-time equivalents? Currently, full-time salaried employees that are not paid a number of hours are reflected as zero under the full-time equivalent column of the report. That question is being addressed as we speak. It is being there will be a box that you can check on the report. If you don't, count the hours for your salaried people now on the report that we have created for you in the company reports file, you will be able to check a box, and it will count all of the salaried or exempt employees as one full-time equivalent. So that should be ready very shortly. Are there any other questions? Okay, aside from transportation, what type of equipment counts? Not sure what you mean by equipment. Well, it depends on the company, type of company that you are. For us, it probably would mean any copier leases that we have, or any computer equipment that we're leasing. Or if you run a construction business, it would be the leases or rental for your moving equipment, your haulers, and things of that nature. So any equipment that you would use in doing business should be considered equipment that would be appropriate for this kind of a loan. So if it's something that you have to pay for in order to do your business, and it is a piece of equipment. Any other questions? I see in the advanced section that there's a section to include health and retirement. Would it be possible to manually enter health and retirement numbers that are not paid directly by BenePay? Leanne, I will get an answer for that. I am sure there is a way that you can manually enter that in. I'm assuming you're talking about the system itself and not the report, but I will touch base with you after this session is over. Another question, do you think website development would be included with equipment? Probably not, because that is a service. It is not a piece of, like a piece of equipment. So any kind of a service that you have that you're paying for would not be included. Any other questions? When you calculate the forgiveness, can you do a what if to determine the best time period to use? Yes. You can run different scenarios on the forgiveness reports. We have two reports under, and if you go under company reports on your system, they will exist there. One, they're both together, and type in PPP on the search and they'll both come up. But yes, you can run a scenario and then you can change the time frame or the number of headcount, et cetera. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you for attending today. Oh, wait, here's one more. So the 24-week period is flexible. We can decide the time frame. Yes, you can. It can be up to 24 weeks. So it's up to you to decide how much time you need. The lending institutions may have set time frames on their forms. I'm not sure, but that doesn't mean that you can't use it and end it earlier than 24 weeks. And we will keep you posted as we find other updates. And Denise has a question, when does the PPP forgiveness paperwork have to be done? I know there's a specific time frame that the lenders are requiring, so it would have to be done pretty close to the time when your PPP forgiveness period is up. Obviously, you have to finish spending the money and finish the period in order to create that report. But the one that we have on file will give you the opportunity to track those costs and have that payroll part of it ready when you are. Talk to your lender about when you need to file the forgiveness application. Thanks for attending today. Have a great afternoon and hope to see you on the webinars again soon. Have a great day.